Question from the brother on my left.
Assalamu alaikum, my name is Atif Sumar and I'm a student, and my question is that Hindu scholars, well, when they're doing idol worship, they claim that they're just worshipping the Almighty God, but the idols are just for concentration. So according to Islam, is it allowed? Is this allowed?
The brother asked the question that the Hindu scholars, they agree that idol worship is wrong, but to concentrate on Almighty God, the idol is only used for concentration. They agree God has got no images, but they use for concentration. So is it right? All these Hindu scholars, they have read the Hindu scriptures, and the scholars agree that Almighty God has got no images. But what they say, that those people who have lower consciousness, they require an idol for concentration. Once you reach a higher level of consciousness, then idol is not required. So I tell these pundits and scholars that those people who have higher consciousness, they don't require an idol to concentrate. So we Muslims have already reached that higher level of consciousness. We don't require any idols to concentrate. Furthermore, once a pandit told me that when we speak to children, we have to make them understand easily. If your child asks you, why does it thunder? So we give the reply that, I macha ki pistiye. It is thundering because I macha ki pistiye, grandmother in the heaven, she is grinding flour. I told him, in Islam, we don't agree in telling a lie, even if it's a white lie. If I tell my son that it thunders because I macha ki pistiye, and when he goes to school, he learns that thundering is due to sudden expansion of rapidly heated air, he will start thinking that my father is telling a lie. What we have to know, we have to speak the truth. The pundits and the scholars, they say that at the lower level, the idol is required for concentration. At a higher level, we don't require concentration. Like how if we study at the lower standard one, it's required, higher level is not required. I tell them that suppose we teach mathematics. In standard 2, when we teach mathematics, we say 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. But the same 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 remains in 10th standard, remains when he does his graduation, it even remains when he does the PhD. The basic teaching of any subject remains the same. 2 plus 2 will remain the same irrespective of its 2nd standard or 10th standard or graduation or PhD. It is very clear that in the Vedas, in the Hindu scriptures, Almighty God has got no images. It's the basics. You can't change your basic. If someone tells me that in standard 2, 2 plus 2 is equal to 5, so you can't tell your son, don't worry, when you reach standard 10, I will tell you 2 plus 2 is not equal to 5. You have to correct him immediately. So it's the duty of all the Hindu scholars to tell the Hindus that according to the Hindu scriptures, Almighty God has got no images. That's the basic. So even at the basic level, they should preach to their followers that idol worship is wrong. Hope that answers the question.
The next question, which is the fourth question of the day and the first on the slip, is by Brother Rohit Shah. He asks, if Islam is the religion of peace, then why does it preach the concept of jihad, that is fighting and killing the kafir? In fact, Hinduism is the religion of peace.
The brother has asked a very important question, that if Islam is a religion of peace, why does it preach about jihad, that is fighting and killing the kafir? In fact, Hinduism is a religion of peace. There's a great misconception as far as jihad in Islam is concerned. This misconception is not only among the non-Muslims, it even among the Muslims. They think that any war fought by any Muslim for any reason, whether it be for personal gain, whether it be for fame, whether it be for money, any war fought by any Muslim is jihad. Jihad does not mean any war fought by any Muslim. Jihad comes from the Arabic word jahada, which means to strive, which means to struggle. In Islamic context, it means to strive against one's own evil inclination. It also means to strive to make the society better. It also means to strive in the battlefield in self-defense. It also means to fight against tyranny and oppression. Jihad basically means to strive, it means to struggle. And very often the critics of Islam, even the Hindu critics, even Arun Shuri, he writes in his book, The World of Fatwa, and he quotes Surah Tawbah chapter number 9 verse number 5, and it says, that the Quran mentions, wherever you find a kafir, into bracket Hindus, wherever you find a kafir, you kill them. And if you open the Quran, and if you read in this Quran, chapter number 9, verse number 5, it does say that wherever you find a kafir, you kill him. But it is a quotation out of context. For the context, read a few verses previous. The first few verses of Surah Tawbah speaks about a peace treaty between the Muslims and the mushriks of Makkah. This peace treaty was unilaterally broken by the mushriks of Makkah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the time he reaches verse number 5, he gives the ultimatum to the enemies, to the mushriks of Makkah. You put things straight in 4 months' time, otherwise the declaration of war. And in the battlefield, Allah says to the Muslims, wherever you find the enemies, wherever you find the kafir, you kill them. This verse of the Quran is talking about the battlefield. When the Muslims are fighting for truth against falsehood, against the enemy, if they come to attack you, don't get scared, kill them. Any army general, to boost up the morale of the soldiers, will say that kill the enemies. He will not say that let the enemies go. So Quran speaks the same. And Arun Shuri, after verse number 5 of Surah Tawbah, jumps to verse number 7. Any intelligent person knows that verse number 6 has the reply to his allegation. Verse number 6 says that if the enemies, if the mushriks want asylum, don't just let them go. Escort them to a place of security so that they will hear the word of Almighty God. The most generous army general today will say that let the enemy go. Which army general today will say that escort the enemy to security? That is what the Quran says. And there is another misconception in Islam that jihad means holy war. Holy war in Arabic is harbu muqaddasa. Nowhere in the Quran is harbu muqaddasa mentioned. Nowhere it's mentioned in the hadith. Holy war is not the translation of jihad. This holy war was first used to describe the crusaders, the Christian crusaders, who conquered many lands and killed thousands of people in the name of Christianity. Now today they use this holy war for Muslims, which is totally wrong. And unfortunately, many Muslim scholars, inverted commas, even they use holy war as a translation from jihad, is totally wrong. Let's analyze what do the Hindu scriptures have to speak about jihad. It's mentioned Bhagavad Gita chapter number 2, verse number 50. Shri Krishna tells Arjun that strive for yoga, that's good for you. Strive means struggle. So even Shri Krishna tells Arjun to strive and struggle. And if you read the Mahabharata speaks about a battle between the cousins, the Kaurav and the Pandavas. There are thousands of verses in Mahabharata which only speak about fighting, multiple times more than the Quran. And if you read Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita is holy scripture of the Hindus. It speaks about advice given by Shri Krishna to Arjun in the battlefield. Bhagavad Gita says in chapter number 1, verse number 42, verse number 46, Arjun says, I would prefer dying unarmed and without fighting rather than kill the cousins, the Kauravas, the son of Dhritarashtra. Shri Krishna replies in the next chapter, chapter number 2, verse number 2, O Arjun, how could such impurities come to your mind that you don't want to fight? You will not enter heaven. How could you get such important thoughts which weakened your hearts? Shri Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 31 to verse number 33, it says, O Arjun, you are a Kshatriya. You should fight. Then only will you go to heaven, otherwise you won't go. And blessed are those Kshatriyas who fight for the truth in the battle. And many of the critics, they speak against Quran and the Hadith. And they quote Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, Book of Jihad, chapter number 2, Hadith 46, in which a prophet said, Mujahid is a person who strives in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if a Mujahid dies in the battlefield, he will go to Jannah, to paradise. And if he wins, he will get the booty of the war. Exactly same thing is mentioned by Shri Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 37. O Arjun, go and fight. If you get killed, you will go to heaven. And if you win the battle, you will enjoy the good of this world, this earthly world. Exactly same thing what is mentioned in the hadith. Imagine if I quote saying that Bhagavad Gita says you should kill your cousins. It will be devilish on my part. I am telling out of context. It will be devilish. The right thing is Bhagavad Gita says that you have to fight for the truth against falsehood. And even if it be your cousin who on the falsehood, even if you have to kill them for the truth, there is no problem. So quoting out of context is devilish. So here we understand that if while speaking with the different types of people, we should know how to convince them. Believe me, hundreds of Hindus have spoken to me and saying jihad is wrong. The moment I say, but isn't it mentioned in Bhagavad Gita that you should kill the cousin? They tell me, no, but that is Sri Krishna is talking about fighting of truth against falsehood. I said, that is what the Quran says. Oh, if that is what the Quran says, then we